Hello everyone, welcome to part 2 of S3. This will be our agenda. We'll see the S3 storage hierarchy. We'll see the concepts of buckets and objects. We'll also see what objects, metadata and storage class are, and then versioning, and of course with demos. Before talking more S3 concepts, let me tell you that S3 will prevalently be used by developers in their programs. Data will be stored in S3 and those data will be accessed by programs written for various purposes. The way data is stored in S3 has a specific structure. S3 follows a storage hierarchy in keeping data. By data, I mean documents, images, videos, etc. There is S3 service. Under that, we have buckets. Here are your objects. By objects, I mean data or videos, files, songs, etc. These objects are stored inside of the buckets. Then the bucket becomes buckets with objects. Management console or S3 APIs can be used to manage buckets and objects. What are buckets actually? If you have used Google Drive, you know that all your data are stored under a single structure called My Drive. You can create multiple folders in your drive, but you cannot create multiple My Drives. A bucket is similar to Google Drive's My Drive, with the exception that you can create multiple buckets. Bucket names have to be globally unique, irrespective of which region they are created in, and also which account those buckets have been created by. If you create a bucket with the name AWS Foundation in, say, Ohio region, and I create a bucket with the same name AWS Foundation Mumbai region, we'll get conflict. We cannot create. I mean, the first one would be able to create, but the second person would not be able to create. So that's why bucket names have to be globally unique. Maximum 100 buckets can be created by an account. You cannot create more than that. This is a soft limit. If you want to create more, you can raise a support ticket with AWS and they can help you out. While communicating using SDKs, endpoints should be used. These endpoints are S3 endpoints. For North Virginia, the endpoint is s3.amazonaws.com. For any other region, it is s3-theregioncode.amazonaws.com. How to access a bucket using URLs? As I told earlier, that S3 would mainly be used by application programmers. SDKs and APIs would be used to do so. Here are the types of URLs those can be used to access a bucket. First one is virtual hosted style. Here, you start with your bucket name, then dot, and then S3 endpoint. If your bucket name is AWS Foundation, then the bucket endpoint URL or bucket endpoint would be http://aws-foundation.theendpoint, s3.amazonaws.com. Or if it is not in North Virginia region, it will be bucket name dot s3-theregionname.amazonaws.com. If you have objects, you can append objects at the end of the URL. Then we have path style. In path style, buckets are accessed using this folder structure. s3 endpoint /bucket name/object name. So if my bucket name is AWS Foundation and I'm using the path style, so I'll use the endpoint first and then slash and then the bucket name, which is AWS Foundation. For any other region apart from North Virginia, you'll have to append the region in between. As bucket names can be accessed using URLs, that's why it is recommended that bucket names follow DNS naming convention. Let's create a bucket and see a few other properties of the same. We'll see transfer acceleration. We'll discuss what requester pays are. I have already shown you how to create a bucket. Let's see it again. Click on S3 and then click on create bucket. Give it a unique name. As I said earlier, the name has to be globally unique. I'll create this bucket in a separate region, let's say US East Ohio. Click on create. The bucket has been created. This is the one which you created in our previous demo, and this is the new bucket which you have created today. If you see, access is mentioned as not public. Then we have region, which is showing which region these buckets have been created in, and then the date created, so when these buckets were created. If you want to see the properties of the bucket, click here. And it will show you what things are there. It is a collective information provided for this bucket. You can go to permissions from here also. You can click on permissions and change the permissions. Or you can hover around the bucket name, click on the bucket, and then you will get four tabs: overview, properties, permissions, and management. Click on permissions, click on public access, and allow list objects. You have obvious reasons not to allow write objects to public because you do not want anyone to upload objects in your bucket and increase the size of it. So click on list objects and then click on save. Then it will show you that this bucket has public access. Click on upload and then add files. So I'm uploading object from a local machine, then click on upload. Here it will show you the upload status. You might have noticed that uploading a very simple object of size 341 KB took some time. If your application cannot afford so much of time, you can enable one property which is called transfer acceleration. Click on properties and then in advanced settings come to transfer acceleration. Click on transfer acceleration and then enable this. Once you enable transfer acceleration, the object or the bucket URL changes. If you see here, now the bucket URL is the bucket name .s3-accelerate.amazonaws.com. So you'll have to use this URL or this bucket URL to upload objects. You can click on save. S3 gives you a very good option to compare how uploading would be faster if you use transfer acceleration. Click on this one and you'll be able to see the comparison. So transfer acceleration has been enabled for this bucket. In this comparison screen, AWS will provide you information that if I use transfer acceleration, how faster it would be as opposed to normal upload. If you see here, if I upload objects from my local machine to Ohio with transfer acceleration, that will be 73% faster. It'll go ahead and show you for each and every region, but transfer acceleration is not free. You'll have to pay some additional charge to use this feature. Let us wait for some time and let's see how the comparison comes out to be. Let's not wait for the entire process to get over because it will take some time. If you see, Oregon and Dublin is saying that if you use transfer acceleration, it will be 36% slower. That means if you use direct upload instead of transfer acceleration, your upload would be faster. But transfer acceleration is chargeable. What will happen in this case? Where if you use transfer acceleration, your upload would be slower. So where transfer acceleration speed is slower or equal to the direct upload speed, AWS will not charge you, even though if you use transfer acceleration endpoint. In Oregon, it is 36% slower. In Dublin, it is 7% slower. Frankfurt, it is 11% slower. So even if you use the transfer acceleration endpoint, AWS will not charge you because it is slower. How does S3 achieves this transfer acceleration or faster upload? So it uses something called CloudFront, which is a content delivery network provided by AWS. We'll discuss CloudFront later on, but remember that in transfer acceleration, AWS uses CloudFront endpoints to achieve the higher upload speed. There is one more property which I want to discuss, that is requester pays. If you store data in S3 buckets created by you, you'll have to bear the cost of the storage. That means suppose if you have stored around 200 gigabytes of data in your S3 bucket, you will have to pay the monthly fees for that storage. You have seen that you can upload and download data to and from your bucket. Upload is fine, but download data incurs some charge. That means if you download something from your S3 bucket, it will be chargeable. Not only you, if anyone downloads from your S3 bucket, that will be chargeable. By anyone, I mean organization or people who have AWS accounts. You'll not be able to download anything from my bucket if you do not have AWS accounts. If you enable requester pays, what would happen is the download would be charged to the account who is downloading, so that the owner of the bucket will not have to pay the download costs done by someone else or some other account. That's where requester pays is. Click on requester pays and if you enable, click on save. This is enabled. Now whomsoever downloads from my bucket, that account would be charged for all the download costs. Objects are actually the data which you want to store in an S3 bucket. Objects can be videos, images, documents, etc., which are stored inside of buckets. They can be much more than what all are listed here. For example, PDF files, Excel sheets, songs like MP3 files, etc. Everything can be thought of as an object. As I mentioned earlier, objects are predominantly binary files. S3 should not be used to store live block data like database files, application files, etc., for which EBS is much better fit. While creating a bucket, name is given to an object. Name is the object key. Let me show you the key of an object. I have uploaded objects in my bucket. You can go to overview and see which objects have been created. Click here. Do not hover on the object name. If you click here, it'll give you a collective information of all the properties of the objects. You can get the same information by hovering on the name, object name, and then clicking. As you know, this is the link which can be used to see this object or download this object. Initially, it will show me access denied because this object does not have public permission. And I'm trying to download it from my browser, so it needs a public permission. How do you change the permission? Go to the permissions tab and then for everyone, click on read object and then save. Alright, having said that, what is object key? This entire URL is the key of this object or the object key. So it starts with HTTPS and then the S3 endpoint slash the bucket name slash the object name. The black underlining is the S3 endpoint. If you see S3 dot the region code, we are using Ohio region dot amazonaws.com. This is the S3 endpoint. Then the bucket name, the blue underlining is the bucket name and the green underlining is the object name. So the entire thing is the object key. There cannot be any sub-bucket or sub-folder inside of a bucket. This is an interesting property. Even though you can create a folder, it does not have any physical existence. It is used in the object key only. Let me show what I mean by that. This is my bucket and this is an object inside of this bucket. The object key would be this. Not only that, this URL can be used to access the object too. I have the same bucket and object. But this time, instead of storing the object directly under this bucket, we create a folder and store this object inside of this folder. The object key this time will have this folder appended to it. What I'll do now is, I'll create a folder and put this exact same object in a folder. Click on create folder and mention the folder name. I do not want any encryption. Keep it as is and then click on save. Click on the folder and you can upload objects in the folder also. I'll upload the same object as I have done for my bucket, which is Superman vs. Batman. Then click on upload. The object is being uploaded. See the difference now. This folder name has been appended ahead of the object name. So now the object key has changed, which has an additional string, which is AWS slash, which is the name of the folder. This folder does not have any physical existence. The only usage of the folder is in the object key name.